I'm Mike Hayslip, and I'm your host for this segment of Garland Perspectives, a series of visits with some of the special people that have contributed so much to Garland's growth and development in this, the 20th century. This series is sponsored by the Garland Sesquicentennial Commission in celebration of our state's 150th year in 1986. Our guest today in the Storer Cable Studios this March 19th is Dr. Taylor Thomas Pickett, who was born in Plano on January 30th, 1906, one of two children of James A. and Della Flip Pickett. Dr. Pickett has brought us today a picture of his parents, which we'd like to show as we go on. His maternal grandparents were L.M.T. and Mary Catherine Flip, who came from Maryland as a bride and groom. Here are their photos. Later, they built this house at Avenue E and 12th Street in Garland, which many old-timers will remember, although it's not there now. His paternal grandfather, Andrew Thomas Pickett, had come to Dallas County in 1851 and settled near the intersection of what is now Loop 12 and Shiloh Road. He married Tabitha Epps of Plano, and we have their pictures as well. The Pickett family was living in Plano when Dr. Pickett was born, so technically he's not a Garland native, although he's about as close as you can come without being one. On horseback, Dr. Pickett attended Garland schools. We have a photo of him with his first horse, which carried him to school. While in Garland schools, he was a member of the football team. And we have a photo of that famous team as well, showing Dr. Pickett in this row. He graduated from Baylor University after going to Garland schools, and we have this photo of him while he was there in the Garland schools. And this photo of him when he was in Baylor University. Also from Baylor University College of Medicine, he interned at Baylor Hospital and in 1932 associated in practice with a Dr. W.W. Shortall, a specialist in internal medicine, where he stayed for 5 years. In 1937, Dr. Pickett opened a second office, which was in Garland, where he practiced until 1983. In 1936, Dr. Pickett married Ida Mitchell, who had been from Denison, and the Picketts have three children, Barbara, John, and James, also one grandchild of which they are justifiably proud. During Dr. Pickett's 52 years of medical practice, 46 of which were spent in Garland, he served as city health officer and taught at Baylor College of Medicine in Dallas. The Picketts are active in Gaston Avenue Baptist Church in Dallas, where he serves as deacon. He has served as chairman of Buckner Baptist Benevolences and is president of the Garland Rotary Club. Do I have the right guy?
That sounds very suspicious.
Suspiciously similar to
you.
Yeah,
it really does.
We're glad to have you with us.
Thank you.
Can you tell us why your family initially back in the 1850s decided to come to Garland?
I think it was a yearning for new frontiers. I don't think there was any specific monetary plan, but there was a desire to be a part of the pioneer families.
And moving southwest at
right.
that time. I think that's probably a pretty normal reason that most people who settled in Dallas County had for coming down here. I just wonder why they chose Dallas County and the Garland area. You have any idea why this other than
No, I do know that when they settled, they wrote to other members of the family to come and join them.
So they must have liked it.
Must have liked it, right.
Okay. What are your earliest recollections of Garland and community, which I guess would include Plano at that time since you were born there?
Well, we moved to the farm north of Garland when I was three, so my memory of Plano is limited.
Okay, so we'll leave Plano out and concentrate on Garland.
Okay. But being a farm boy and growing up about 2.5 miles northwest of Garland was a very fortunate thing so far as I was concerned. Maybe I didn't realize it so much at that time, but as I look back, having the freedom of the outdoors and an opportunity to mix with nature, in which part of that was milking six cows twice a day.
That was your first job, I take it.
Yes, yes. But at any rate, those memories, of course, I can remember the first Ford automobile that we received, and we learned to drive it out in the middle of the pasture, and my dad gave me some lessons.
Well, that's interesting. You remember a Ford automobile, and I notice you have a Ford pickup, and you remember being on the farm, and I notice that since you've retired from active medical practice, you're now a gentleman farmer. What do you think this has to say after all these years? Your earliest memories you're redoing right now.
I suppose that's just something in my genes that has just gradually been on the back burner until I had an opportunity to rejuvenate it. So
while you took 52 years out to be a physician.
Right.
All right. So once you got the chance, you went back to where you started.
Right.
Okay. What can you tell us about your early schooling in Garland? We already know that you rode a horse to get here. You haven't given us the old walking 10 miles in the snow routine. You've told us how you got here. And well, what do you remember about the schools?
Well, I think the school environment was very enjoyable. I had a problem of not being able to, at least not being on time in the first grade a few times, and the class would always sing a little song to me about being late, and I can recall that that was a little bit, embarrassing, yes. It gave me a realization that it was proper to be on time, and as a result of that, I suppose that's been one of my hang-ups. I think that a guy, if he's got an appointment, ought to be on time.
And you carried that all the way from the first grade when those kids sang songs to you.
Could be.
What were your favorite subjects back in those days? What do you recall about courses or teachers
in
Garland schools?
Well, geography and math and some of the science courses were all interesting to me. Annabelle Newman was one of my teachers in the, I believe it was the seventh grade. We were in the, Mr. Bussey was our superintendent.
E.D. Bussey.
E.D. Bussey. And Margaret Newman, another one of the Newman family, I recall, as being teachers along. I think my school activities was very average. I don't recall.
You don't remember being a stellar performer academically?
I'm afraid not.
That was later. What sort of science courses did you have in Garland schools back in those days? And we're talking pre-1920
yes.
or there.
Well, there was some chemistry and some I recall some anatomy discussions and all. I don't recall a lot of science background, but physics and chemistry are two that it was.
Do you remember what caused you to want to go on to college and become a physician? It was a time when not that many people did go on from that point. What was it about your family or your upbringing that made you want to?
I seem to have made that decision when I was about 12 years old. And never varied from that other than to consider other possibilities.
Do you remember why? What?
Yes, it was an experience that wasn't too delightful. The removal of my tonsils at age 5 was an experience that I had a little trouble forgetting. One doctor held me in his lap with his arms wrapped around me while the other doctor, without anesthesia, propped my mouth open and took my tonsils out.
So you remembered that?
I remember that. The only, I think I got what they called a little bird egg. It was a piece of candy as a reward for being a good patient.
So from that experience, you focused your attention on
that? That was the first. Then at age 10, the tonsil tags were removed, and that was the time that made it rather definite that I wanted to learn to handle a people in a more humane attitude and be able to help them to grow.
Can you tell me what tonsil tags are? You're using a term there that I'm not familiar with.
Okay, well, in removing the tonsils, if the little slip that goes over them and peels them out doesn't get the whole tonsil, there's a bit at the base that's left, and that continues to get infected and give problems. And that
so you haven't done the job if you don't get it all.
Not complete.
Yeah. So you had two tonsillectomies. You had the distinction of having done that.
Right.
And decided you wanted to go on to medical school.
And I think my decision was not one that I was, trying to get back at somebody. I had a feeling that there ought to be a better way.
And you could do a better way. You went to Baylor University. What was your experience in coming from the Garland schools at that time into a university environment? I believe you told me you went through in 3 years your undergraduate degree by going year round. You must have had sort of a drive there to get that done and get on with the program.
Well, I think I had the same experience most freshmen have, that's a big jump from high school to the university. But I was fortunate to have contacts with people whose guidance and advice put me in pretty good shape, and I was able to enjoy my work.
Well, now, you say in the Garland schools, at least as a high school student, you don't remember yourself as a stellar performer, yet most of us know that to get into medical school, you've got to be a cut above the rest, so something happened to you between your graduation from Garland schools and your entry into medical school, else I would assume you would not have been there. Would that be correct?
I would have to be fair in saying that getting into medical school at that time was not as acute as it is at the present time. But I was still an average student. I would say a B would put me in good state.
What sort of recreational opportunities did you have as a teenager or in the 20s, your 20s in Garland? What, socially or athletically? I know you played on a football team, and we've got a photograph of that.
I was not an outstanding football player. I mean, I look at that picture with a great deal of pride because most of the guys on there were outstanding athletes, and I was just fortunate to get to be associated with them. The social life involved going to parties, and I enjoyed the contacts on our farm. There were a number of families whose children were about my age, and we would play together.
Were they tenants on your family farm?
Right.
So you had ample opportunity to associate with other people.
Blacks and whites, we were equally. I mean, we didn't. We were colorblind, in other words.
Well, that's very interesting. Back in those days, after all we've been through in the time in between, and you grew up with those folks not knowing any different, right?
Right.
Okay. What sort of parties were given? I mean, there was a young lady you were talking about dating when we visited the other day, and whose father was a physician here, I think, and you... you must have had some sort of parties in the homes, or were they?
Largely, that was it. They were just parties in the home. They were not big parties. They were just small groups, and we had some very delightful times.
I know that you've had a sort of a lifelong association with the Baptist Church, and you've been very active in Baptist activities. Did you initially join the Baptist Church when you were in Garland?
Right.
Okay, and this sort of formed a part of your life that stuck.
Right.
Do you remember any other churches, or do you remember any specific ministers, or are there any memories that stand out in your mind church-wise that back in those days that you think caused you to stick with it as faithfully as you have?
Well, I would have to say all of them had an influence. Now, so far as the Garland group, I had some very wonderful Sunday school teachers and the pastors that I was associated with all had an influence on my life. I made my decision to accept the Lord as my Savior at age 8, and I was in the Antioch Baptist Church at that time.
Now, the Antioch Baptist Church was the first, not as in First Baptist, but the first of the Baptist churches
right.
in Garland, I believe.
Right.
And where was that located?
Well, where the present chapel or of the First Baptist Church is located on that corner.
One of the things that I'd like to talk to you about in some length and some detail to get an education from you is health and medicine in the early days. And we touched on it a minute ago. We talked about your 2 tonsillectomies that you had. What do you remember about health and medicine in the early days of Garland? This is prior to your going to medical
right.
school, of course.
I remember one particular incident in which my dad developed what we call erysipelas. It's a streptococcus infection of the skin. It involved his entire scalp. All his hair came out, and he was...
I wonder if that's what's the matter with mine.
I'm not sure. I doubt if these are related. But at any rate, my dad was being cared for by, I believe, a Dr. Brown here in Garland.
C.S. Brown.
And he was very intimate in our family. And I can recall one or two nights that my mother and I spent a great deal of time in prayer for my dad, because we doubted seriously if he would survive. But they developed a little serum that seemed to have helped him. And all of that had its effect on making me interested in further.
Okay, so we have your father's illness, we have your tonsillectomies. What else do you remember? Do you remember anything medicine-wise? What, you mentioned the serum. What happened as a kid when you got sick?
Well, usually the doctor came out and he rolled up some tablets of calomel and so forth and put them in a little paper.
So he did his own dispensing?
He dispensed his own medicine.
Well, what about the drug stores? How did they feel about that if the doctor
Well, was... they furnished him the things he dispensed, and they still had...
They got theirs.
They too. Got theirs, yeah. Mr. Peter Hanley and...
An early druggist
yes,
here.
Yeah.
Okay, so the physician made what was known then as a house call.
Right.
And probably did so by buggy, right?
Right.
All right, so the physician would arrive, and what sort of a range of medicines were available back then? You mentioned calomel. How heavy was his bag, in other words? What did he have that he could do?
Well, he had certain instruments to pull teeth and open boils and sew up.
Now, are we talking about an M.D. now?
Well, some of these turned out
or
to be...
Or a barber.
At any rate, he was prepared to meet the emergency, let's say.
So that would be a dental emergency?
Sewing up a wound. Or...
All right. What we'd call a physiological type thing any sort. What was he prepared to do in terms of bedside manner? You mentioned some question in your mind about the way that doctors handled people back in those days?
Well, the doctors, aside from that one experience of my surgery, always seemed to me to be a part of the family when they came. They were concerned about everything and everybody as well as the patient. And
okay. You got out of Baylor College of Medicine, and I believe you told me the other day you chose to affiliate with a Dr. Shortall in Dallas. Can you tell us a little bit about what it was like to look for your first professional job?
Well, during my internship, of course, I was associated with him considerably. He was an outstanding surgeon in Dallas, and I had the privilege of assisting him in surgery, and his personality, as well as his ability, was very appealing to me. And of course, when I graduated in 31, that was pretty much in the depressed area of our major depression. And I was not, being a farm boy and having had nobody else in the family as physicians, I sort of had a feeling of, being left hanging on a limb, so to speak. So I just
You didn't have an uncle to go join
right,
in practice.
That's right. So I did go to Dr. Shortall and tell him that I'd like to just hang around the office if he didn't mind, and if they had any house calls or anything that they didn't want to do, to let me do it. And so that's how my practice started.
Now, he was a surgeon, I believe
right.
you said.
Mm-hmm.
Was that considered a specialty in those days
right.
as it is today?
Right. General surgeon, though, it wasn't.
All right, so it was not a specific type of surgeon
right.
as we would have today where we would designate him. And was surgery also your specialty?
No. I worked in the clinic of Shortall, Bumpus, and Pickett. My role was that of internal medicine. So actually, I practiced internal medicine there in Dallas for 5 years.
Diagnostic
and
this sort of
thing. Yeah.
So you handled the diagnostic end, and he handled the surgical
yeah.
end. Okay. What do you remember back during those times? What did an office visit cost back then? Just out of curiosity.
Well, I remember specifically when I came to Garland, 50 cents was a rather high office
People
call.
Complained about the
yeah,
50 cents.
Yeah, yeah.
And you came to Garland in 1937.
Seven, right.
Okay. But you don't remember what it was in Dallas.
Well, in other words, $1, $1.50, $2 were about, as I recall, office calls and major, rather definite procedures. $5 would be
okay.
considered.
So was it higher in Dallas than it was?
Yes.
Oh, the market would bear more.
Right.
Dallas. Okay, and they expected it to be higher. I wondered about that. So you worked with this clinic in Dallas until 1937, I believe.
Right.
Then you had your own office after that time.
Right.
You had one in Dallas, I believe, and you also had one in Garland.
Right.
How did you manage to juggle between two offices? You were the guy they were coming to see, and yet you had two places.
Well, I sort of seemed to get a rest between the two offices. In other words, as I was driving in from Garland, I could sort of reflect on some of the things that happened. And it didn't seem as far as it actually was at that time. And I didn't feel the pressure of two offices as much as some of my patients felt like I should. But the reason for it, of course, was that in my Dallas practice after 5 years, I had a clientele that I was real appreciative of, and they seemed willing to stay with me. So I felt sort of obligated to have that office, and it didn't work out bad. But
did you have to have two staffs also?
Well, yes, but they didn't amount to a whole lot. I mean, a secretary and an assistant. My wife, when we came to Garland, was the nurse in my office. And
you had the good judgment to marry a nurse. So
right. And she and I had the delightful experience of delivering a number of babies in the home when I first came to Garland.
How many babies besides me did you deliver in your career here?
Mike, I have a record of over 1,200.
That's a lot of folks to put on the planet. For one guy.
Yes, but you have no idea what a delight I have, in present company included, the development of these people. Now, I have the privilege of having developed a heart surgeon who is with Dr. Ochsner in New Orleans, in a very outstanding medical school. He was the top man in his class. That caliber, we had a lot of those among the children I delivered, and somehow I had a feeling that that was, I had a part in it because I was interested in them after I delivered them.
Okay, who was in Garland as a physician when you opened your office here? I mean, we now have a Yellow Pages full of all different sorts of specialties, and I have a feeling there were just a few.
Yes, Dr. Freeman and Dr. Herndon, and I'm not sure. I think that Dr. Ramsey had died. I remember about him, but those are the two that I recall specifically.
So Garland had two physicians at that time, and you were the hometown boy returned.
Came home with a little bit of concern because the Bible said you better watch out for your hometown. They might not appreciate you.
A prophet is not without honor saving his own country,
boy.
I think that's what
it is. That's good. That's right.
All right. You had trepidations about this.
Not a lot, but some.
Did you find it a problem?
Well, yes and no. I mean, a lot of them just call me Taylor, and I liked that. And a lot of them talked about when I wore overalls to school and when I worked in a little garage during the summer, things like that brought back memories. But as time went on, it seemed that my ability as a physician became accepted. And if I had it to do over, I'd do it again. I mean.
Okay. That's very interesting. We'll get back to that in a minute. At that time, Garland was what, about 1,800 people?
No, there was about...
In 1937.
I have 2,500 in mind,
okay.
But I may be...
We're not talking about a lot of difference.
Okay.
Percentage-wise,
okay.
We are. But,
right.
But there were three of you then, as far as locally, that were handling the patient load for that number of people. Do you have any idea how many doctors Garland has now, 50 years later, 49 years later?
Well, I'd say close to 200.
Okay. Well, Garland seems to have been a town that attracted, for one reason or another, physicians to come out here. We seem to have gotten at least our share of people in the specialty practices and whatnot.
I've had more than a half a dozen who came through my office to establish practices here.
When you say through your office, do you mean they associated with you?
Yes, that's right.
To begin with.
Mm-hmm.
But did you not practice for the most part solo, as we might say?
I'd say yes. Those times were temporary because these young fellows were just beginning to get their feet on the ground.
Kind of like you were with Dr. Shorter.
That's exactly right.
You were what we used to call, in the old days, if you'll pardon the expression, a GP or a general practitioner. We've got another name for it now. We call it family practice. Is that about the same thing?
Right.
You chose to do that, apparently, rather than specialize in some area like surgery. Can you tell us why you would have done that in those days, what the decisions were like?
Well, now, you understand, for 5 years I practiced in Dallas as an internist, internal medicine.
Right.
So when I came to Garland, there was that different situation. Dr. Quinn, whose office I came into, had a number of OB patients, and I had delivered babies. I mean, I wasn't a novice in that line. So it became necessary for me to be a general practitioner.
Right.
And I liked it, and so I stayed with it.
So you had to rise to the occasion.
Right.
You couldn't limit or restrict your practice to.
Not very many internists, I would say, become family practitioners, but a certain number.
Generally, it works the other way.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Okay. What were the other doctors in town also general practitioners?
Yes.
And they would refer, I presume, certain cases
right.
to specialists in Dallas. And how many hospitals did you have in the area back then?
Baylor was the main one in St. Paul. They were right near each other. And then Parkland, of course.
Okay. My guess is that You've seen more changes in medical practice in your 52 years of practice than in all prior recorded history of medicine. Would you tell us some of those changes and most significant ones?
I would agree with you. I think I've had the privilege and joy of practicing in the golden age of medicine. I just wouldn't swap it with anybody. Mike, I think one of the things that stands out in regard to the drug situation of wonder drugs, I recall specifically one patient that I had in Baylor with pneumonia. And at that time, penicillin was not known, but sulfa was a drug that was becoming available. So I was able to get some sulfa to start treating this patient, and he was improving. But the supply of sulfa ran out, and I had nothing to supply that need, and the patient died. And that has stuck with me, that as medicine progresses, a lot of people pay the price of waiting until their medication has...
So you're saying one of the big changes is the availability
of wonder drugs.
Yeah. What are some of the other changes?
Oh, well, of course, we know that the heart surgery and all of those things are just almost beyond imagination back in our day, in the beginnings. But, of course, I think the surgical techniques and all have been improved to the degree that things that were major surgery now are considered minor. And of course, it's usually minor on the other fellow. If it's on you, it more or less becomes major.
Yeah, pretty major if it's yours, I guess.
Yeah.
What are you, looking back, do you see any changes in the type of problems that people came to you with in the early days as opposed to now? I mean, has there been a change in the mix of maladies that we might say?
Yes, I think so.
What were those changes?
Well, I think there's been a change in the feeling of security on the part of the patients. They tend to become more anxious about themselves and about concern about their family and other people. In other words, the anxiety element in medicine has become a major thing. And that's a part of almost every illness.
I wonder why?
Well, the unknown, I suppose.
Okay, but it was unknown 50 years ago,
right,
too.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I wonder why the unknown bugs them worse now than it used to.
I don't know that I have that.
Do you think there's a greater educational level?
Possibly that's a part of it, yes, because some patients want to know all the things you know.
So 50 years ago, if my stomach hurt, I'd call the doctor and expect to get some sort of
medicine, but he
simple
didn't
remedy. But
tell
today,
you what was the matter. You didn't ask him what was the matter. You just said, Doc, here I am sick, cure me.
Yeah. So today I read all the magazines and I listen to the TV and I begin to envision all that might be wrong
within
that part of me, and that develops it. What do you think about the change as far as specialization is concerned? I mean, isn't that another big change that has occurred, if I might be redundant, within your career?
Yes, I think so. I mean, I think it's very comforting to know that when you have a specific problem, that there is a specialty to take care of it.
Okay.
I would like to say, Mike, that I have some specialist friends say the reason they're specialists, they didn't have enough sense to be family practitioners. Of course, now, that's facetious, but in a way, the general practitioner or the family practitioner has to know something about everything.
That's the first line of defense,
that
anybody has. It's probably very demanding. What do you think gave rise to all this specialization? The increasing complexity of the medical and surgical techniques, or what?
I think so. I mean, I think it was just a normal outgrowth of progress.
And you would consider it progressive?
Oh, yes.
Let me ask you this. You were also what was called city health officer in Garland for a number of years. What did that involve?
It was a very interesting experience.
It's an august title. What did it mean?
Hot Alexander was mayor at this particular time. Dr. Herndon had been health officer, and he was either planning to leave Garland or he did leave. And Hot asked me if I wouldn't accept that.
There was a big salary to this, I presume.
Without pay.
Without pay.
Yeah. And he said, I think you'll get some satisfaction from it, but no rewards. And
Monetary.
But at any rate, it did give me a certain status that I was kind of pleased, because they requested my attendance in all the city council meetings, and I just sat in as a listener, but occasionally they would ask me questions. But they sort of expected me to be there.
And okay, well, what were the duties of a city health officer?
Well, of course, it primarily was to promote a healthy environment which would work against any sort of a widespread disease process.
Or an epidemic.
Epidemic,
or something
like
this.
Yeah.
Well, what did that include? Was your focus on homes, or was it on restaurants, or was it on school cafeterias?
It started on homes and children. I can recall some children dying with diphtheria when I first came to Garland.
That was before the diphtheria vaccine.
Right. And then I think the polio experiences are some that I shall never get away from. In other words, the development of vaccines and preventive medicine has just been a very delightful opportunity to see how the progress of knowledge has been applied to conquering disease.
Mm-hmm. Okay, during this time that you were working with your profession, you were also involved in some civic and service sort of things. I know you were in the Rotary Club. You did a lot of work with the Baptist Church and with Baptist-affiliated things. Can you tell us a little bit about that, other than the fact that you had a title? What was the work like that you did outside of your profession at that time, like in the Rotary Club or with the Buckner Benevolence?
Well, of course, now the Rotary Club is very near to my heart. Hack Roach was the one who brought me into the Rotary Club, and he told the club, he said, now Taylor's a physician, and you needn't expect him to be 100% in attendance, because he's going to have people that need his time. And I just thought to myself, now Hack, that might not be so. Hack has 58 years.
I believe it's 59.
59, and I have 58 years, 48 years of perfect attendance in Rotary. But at any rate, that was a challenge. Yeah, that was a challenge. But in 1955, Rotary was 50 years old, and I had the privilege of being president that year, and went to Seattle, Washington for the international meeting. And then Ida and I have gone to about a half a dozen other international meetings since then, to Nice, France, and Hawaii, and various foreign areas. I think that the association with Rotary as a worldwide influence for peace is a very gratifying thing. I believe it has more ability to put the desire for peace in the heart of people than any organization I've ever been associated
with. That's very interesting. I haven't had it expressed that way. What about the Buckner Benevolence Group?
Well, there again, my association started in 49. I was invited to be a trustee. And then the association with those trustees and the growth of that benevolent from Buckner Children's Home out here on the hill, it has spread all over the state of Texas with some big institutions in all the major cities. Mm. So it's been a very delightful thing. And there again, I don't know how it happens, but I had the privilege of being president or chairman of the Board of Trustees the year that Buckner was 100 years old. And something was uncovered at that time that I didn't even know about, but they were looking through the charter members, charter trustees, and they ran upon the name of A.T. Pickett. And I said, well, that's my granddad. And sure enough,
so
he was one of the first trustees. So
the Pickett family in three generations spanned 100 years with Buckner. That's very interesting. What can you tell us about major events in Garland? Now, you were in medical school or in college at the time of the tornado in 27, so you probably don't...
The coach, however, of our football team was one who lost his life in that, in that tornado.
Okay. What do you remember about the Depression insofar as it affected Garland?
I would give my parents the benefit of not realizing how poor we were.
You didn't even know you were
didn't
in the
even
Depression.
Know it. I mean by that, my dad said, now, you go to Baylor, you get your degree, and we'll take care of you the Milky Way. And that's the way he had of saying that he'd back up my, mm-hmm. because our dairy was one that was a very important part of our.
So you went to college on milk.
Yeah, right.
That says what sent you down there. What do you remember about collecting money or fees as a physician in the Depression? You came out here just as we were coming out of the Depression.
Right. Well, the fees in Dallas were, I'd say, minimal to nothing. In other words, I delivered a number of babies there that I didn't expect to get any pay for. And you always want to know, well, did you receive chickens and hogs and things? I can say that we had some people who used those means of paying their bills and all, but I would have to say, all in all, my patients have been the most appreciative group of people I've ever known, and they have shown it by taking care of their side of the story.
Okay, what about any epidemics in Garland?
Garland never had an epidemic during the time I was health officer, and that was something I gave the Lord credit for, because that's a very unusual experience for a town our size. But we have never had an epidemic, actually.
Do you think Garland's a healthy town or a health-conscious town?
I think a little above average in that regard.
And so that may be one of the reasons we've never had that.
Probably.
What do you remember about the flood in Garland around 49, 50? You were here then.
Yes, I was in Dallas, and when I came back out, I was not able to get home. I had been night on the with my sister on the west side of Duck Creek.
But what are the biggest changes? We've talked about the changes in medicine. What are the biggest changes in the town you've seen since the early days? If you had to look back and highlight certain things that are different, maybe talk about them as being good or bad? Or
Mike, I think that the industrialization of Garland has become a very outstanding thing. And yet the base, as I look back, was that row of churches right up and down what street?
It'd be Ninth Street.
Ninth Street and the school right across. So the churches and the schools, to me, were the bedrock of the foundation on which Garland built. And I think that's significant.
Okay. What... who were the influential people in Garland that you recall?
Well, of course, Mr. Rip Davis and Mr. H.W. Jones.
Hardware merchant.
Hardware man. and the bakers and
hardware and furniture.
Furniture. Peter Hanley.
The druggist.
And
why are you only mentioning men?
I'm not a chauvinist. I suppose but during that time, men were the men. They were the. In other words, we recognized the power behind the throne, but we also realized that the men received the major.
Is that then one of the changes you've seen happening?
I think so. All yeah, right. Because
so today we.
Ms. Buchholz and few people like that have changed the.
You want to stay out of their way if they get if they get behind something,
right,
don't you?
Right.
Okay, so those are the people you remember. Why do you think Garland? Now you were born in Plano. You said you moved when you were 2 or 3 years old. Out of all these communities, Plano included, why do you think Garland is the 10th largest city in the state? Why do you think we have what we've got here in town that you've been very complimentary of? What factors?
Well, I think Garland has had a very aggressive group of leaders who have, as President Brooks, when I was at Baylor, always said, take the long look. Not just today, but take the long look. And that is one of the things. But I still go back to the fact that I feel like that the Lord had something to do with Garland's progress. And we need to recognize the fact that we're not quite as important as people might lead us to believe, and when we realize that he's the fellow in charge.
Yeah. Okay, so you think the strength of Garland's churches then was very significant?
Very significant, I really do.
Okay. What are you proudest of in your time in Garland?
Pride has never been a title that I have yearned for. I think gratitude for the people whose lives I've touched. I guess that's the most.
Specific project or work?
No, of course my patients would be at the top of the list, of course they'll always be there. Then of course the other organizations and things that we've been associated with.
What are your regrets during your years in Garland?
It's awfully hard for me to find many, really.
Anything you'd do differently if you had it to do over again?
My family, my children, my wife, in a way, as I look back, they were partners with me in the practice of medicine, because a lot of my time that the average person could be spending with their family had to be spent with my patients. But they recognized it, and now as I look back and talk to the kiddos about it, they said, Dad, you gave us all the time we needed. Well, of course, that's gratifying.
So you made a family deal out of medicine the way that the Picketts did out of the dairy.
I guess so. I guess that's right, because Ida and being a nurse, and we just understood what the practice of medicine meant.
Okay, as the dean of physicians in Garland, probably the eldest physician that we've had here, and a person that's enjoyed now 80 years on this earth, I know that you've got some advice, both in terms of living in general and in terms of people settling in or staying in Garland. What might that advice be that you have to share in conclusion with us?
Well, Chris, I am strong on digging in and staying put. I think the person that's changing from this to that may be broadening his scope, but until he settles to one thing I do, and I think that's what's happened in Garland. I've always resented the bedroom city. I don't think it's
that image.
I don't think it's ever been that. And I think there are people in Garland who work elsewhere, but there are a lot of people who live elsewhere that work in Garland. So I really think that the determination to stay with what you select as your life work and let the other things fall where they may is one of the things that I think is most important.
Okay. Perseverance.
Perseverance, yeah.
Anything else?
Well, I go back to the fact that I feel that unless one has a feeling of the Lord's leadership in his life, he's lost. And he is unstable much more than anyone who has not had that experience.
Well, those are some good comments that we appreciate. We appreciate, we'll get to that one. Right on the front. I didn't forget that one. I won't get to it.
Yeah.
I want to thank you for joining us today.
Well, it's my delight. I feel real honored to have this privilege.
I also want to thank you for the 52 years of medical practice, for the fact that you didn't mention my delivery as one of your regrets. I was concerned about that for a while, that you might do that.
One of my delights.
You've been a sort of a beacon to a number of us around here for a lot of years, and I know that you've been an inspiration to some other younger physicians in Garland that join me in expressing thanks for what you've done.
Thank you.
And so, for Garland Perspectives, this concludes today's segment. Thank you very much for being with us, and so long until next time.